Okay, well, welcome everybody. Is the microphone working? It is correct. Okay, good. Welcome to our session on freedom, Locke, and liberalism. My name's Mary Keyes. I teach in the political science department here at Notre Dame, and it's a pleasure to welcome you all. Unfortunately, we're missing one of our three distinguished panelists who could not make it, but on the plus side, we have two distinguished panelists, so we'll have more time to interact with their ideas and for question and answer. Susan McWilliams, with regrets, could not make it, so she's our missing in action panelist. But the two who could be here, and we're very grateful for that, are, first of all, Michael Zuckert, my colleague here at Notre Dame. Michael is the Nancy Reeves Drew Professor of Political Science here at Notre Dame. His fields of expertise are political theory, constitutional law, and studies. He's a concurrent professor in the law school at Notre Dame, as well as a fellow for the Nanavik Institute for European Studies. He has many books, as you're all aware, probably, but they include Natural Rights and the New Republicanism, Launching Liberalism, John Locke and the Liberal Tradition, and together with Catherine Zuckert, Leo Strauss and the Problem of Political Philosophy. Professor Zuckert has received grants from the National Endowment for the Humanities, the Woodrow Wilson Center, the Earhart Foundation, and the National Science Foundation, and has taught at Carleton College, Cornell University, Claremont Men's College, Fordham University, the University of Minnesota, the University of Michigan, and last but not least, the University of Chicago, and of course, Notre Dame. David Schindler, our second distinguished panelist, is an associate professor of metaphysics and anthropology at the John Paul II Institute in Washington, D.C. He received his PhD in philosophy from the Catholic University of America in 2001 with a dissertation on Hans Urs von Balthasar. He taught previously at Villanova University from 2001 to 2013, first in the philosophy department and then in the Department of Humanities, which was his tenure home in 2007. He's the author of The Catholicity of Reason, the editor of a much beloved and fine international journal of Catholic thought, which is called Communio, many of you are familiar with, since 2002. And together with his wife and Notre Dame PhD, Jeannie Heffernan Schindler, he is most recently the editor of the Robert Spemann Reader, which just came out about a month ago from Oxford University Press. So we're really delighted to have both Professor Schindler and Professor Zuckert with us today for what promises to be, a vigorous and diverse discussion of Locke, freedom, and liberalism. Each of our panelists will speak for about 20 minutes, and then we'll be able to open the floor to questions. Professor Zuckert asked me to announce that due to circumstances that were both foreseen and beyond his control, he needs to leave 15 minutes early. So it will not be in protest or not a displeasure with your questions. He simply must depart at a quarter to noon. So, but again, that is one positive aspect of the two panelist situation. We should have plenty of time for questions for Professor Zuckert. So Professor Zuckert will speak first, just following the order of the program, followed by Professor Schindler, and then we'll open the floor to questions from the audience. Okay, so please join me in welcoming our panelists.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention please. If Stephen Bartolico could please come to the information desk, we would appreciate it. Thank you.
Is that anybody here? my title is Freedom and Modernity, and I wanted to begin with a paradox about modernity. As this conference, I think, partly attests, there is a general association made between, in our minds anyway, between modernity and the political moral goal of freedom. Indeed, one of the greatest of our modern political texts is simply called On Liberty. And yet, if we look at the bodies of thought which together went into the what we might think of as the emergence of modernity, we see something rather different. The clusters of thought that I have in mind that in some combination seem to have contributed to the formation of the ideas that are dominant in modernity are Protestantism, modern science, and modern philosophy. Most of the leading thinkers of the Reformation were noted for their deep reservations about freedom. In this context, freedom understood mostly as free will. So Luther, for example, wrote a powerful tract against free will, in which he was followed by most of the most important Protestant theologians. Modern science sought to explain nature in strictly necessitarian terms. It formulated a paradigm of explanation that appealed solely to mechanical causation, with the aim of banishing everything that smacked of miracle, mystery, or free action in nature. Modern philosophy, in the form of Cartesianism, Spinozism, or Lockean empiricism, aimed to provide the philosophic grounding for the scientific aspiration that I just mentioned. The philosophers also attempted to explore the implications of the new necessitarian perspective for human action, morals, and politics. Perhaps the most revealing of the modern philosophers in this regard was Thomas Hobbes. He developed a philosophy of mankind that posited human beings as acting solely in terms of the laws of inertia, with action caused by the play of those motions called passions on or in the human person. An emblematic part of Hobbes's science of humanity, therefore, was his claim not only that there is no such thing as free will, but there is no such thing as will. Will, says Hobbes, is merely the last passion that determines action. Moreover, Hobbes's psychology and moral philosophy culminated in a political philosophy that left little room for liberty. The driving forces in human nature produce a situation that Hobbes called a war of all against all. That is, put a little more prosaically, the human passions set human beings against each other. He identified three reasons in the passions for this war or opposition between human beings. These passions are competition, diffidence, and glory. We are made in such a way, he says, that we necessarily desire goods of the world. And these goods are finite and therefore scarce. We inevitably compete for these limited goods with our fellows. At the same time, he points out, we are fearful of our fellows, and our passion of fear leads us to make war, often sneakily, as we are driven to attempt to forefend the attacks on others by the attacks by others on us by preempting them. Finally, there's the passion of glory, which Hobbes understands to be the pleasure that we take in being superior to others, in receiving honor from them, and in general enjoying prestige in society. Glory, he thinks, is an especially vicious passion because it sets us in conflict with our fellows merely for the sake of dominating them or being superior to them. It is, in a sense, much less rational and yet often far more potent than competition or diffidence. Now, since human beings are so readily driven into conflict with each other, Hobbes thought, it was neither wise nor possible even to leave human nature free to play itself out, nor is it possible to reform people by appealing to their reason. Reason, he says, is unable to control the passions. Thus, Hobbes rejected the approach that had dominated since Aristotle, the approach that understood the key to moral and political life to be education to virtue. This virtue was to allow men to become free, to a degree anyway. Hobbes thought that to be an extraordinarily naive and unscientific view of mankind. Instead, Hobbes posited as the solution to the human conundrum a very powerful state apparatus that through law and the threat of force would control those unruly human passions and allow people to live together in peace. It would be difficult, I think, to identify Hobbes as a partisan of freedom, such as we generally associate with modernity. So the upshot is that the foundation of modernity seems quite uncongenial with the great modern emphasis on freedom. That observation leads me to my task today, which is to explore how modernity became so open to freedom and to explore the philosophic ground of that openness. Now this is, as you will guess, a very large task, and I only have 20 minutes, so I have to deal with it in a very truncated way. I will do that by focusing on John Locke, a thinker who was much involved in all three clusters of thought which led to modernity, and who also was very influenced by Hobbes. But I want to argue he was not influenced by Hobbes, or at least he broke with Hobbes, importantly, on the two matters that I have emphasized so far. He develops a theory to show that human beings are indeed by nature free, and he rejects the Hobbesian megastate, initiating instead the liberalism of limited government that we associate with modernity. Now, so like Hobbes, Locke begins with the state of nature, which is, more prosaically again, the claim that human beings are not naturally subject to political authority. His treatment of the making of political society is driven by one major question. Here is the question: if man in the state of nature be so free, if he be absolute lord of his own person and possessions, equal to the greatest and subject to nobody, why will he part with that freedom by creating a state which has authority over him? So when Locke asks why men leave the freedom and equality of the state of nature, he is asking why human beings cannot live together without the coercive institutions of the state. The state of nature, he posits, is a state in which people are perfectly free of all law and all subjection, except the law of nature. He assumes that there is a law of nature, a set of moral rules known to people and by which they are capable of regulating their behavior. The existence and effectiveness of this law seems to distinguish Locke's version of the state of nature from Hobbes's. However, Locke's state of nature degenerates into a state of war despite the law of nature. In the state of nature, there can be two different kinds or sorts of uses of force: force without right, that is to say, violations of the law of nature, and force with right, that is, attempts to punish or deter violations of the law of nature. Even when individuals know the moral rule that is to govern their actions, they are tempted to use force without right. We live, he says, in a penurious world relative to the needs and desires that we have. The penuriousness of this world can be overcome only with painful labor. Hence, there is a constant temptation, he sees, to violate the labor and ownership claims of others in order to acquire goods without labor. But it must be noted that Locke nowhere emphasizes or places any particular reliance on glory or on that desire for dominion or domination over others that Hobbes had seen as so prominent among the causes of force. Locke's account rests on what Hobbes calls competition and diffidence, but not on glory. The end result is what Locke gently calls the great inconvenience of the state of nature, that inconvenience being that the basic rights of life, liberty, etc., are very insecure. So harsh as it may be to live under coercive government, Locke shows that the situation without government is worse than with it. So his answer to his own question of why people leave the state of nature then is that the absence of public coercive power leads to an intolerable situation. Desire to dominate others is not a part of Locke's account of how and why that happens. Without the intense drive for glory, honor, and the like, Locke is able to show that the natural enmity can be more readily tamed than Hobbes had thought, and so we do not need Hobbes's Leviathan state, but a milder constitutionalist regime will generally do. Thus, Locke develops that crucial stand of liberal politics, the commitment to limited government and freedom. Locke disagrees with Hobbes about the nature of good and rightful government because he disagrees with Hobbes about the causes of war, or less poetically put, because he disagrees about human nature. I'm going to take as my leading question now, why does Locke not consider glory and related phenomena to be central to human nature as Hobbes had done? Most significant here is Locke's revision of Hobbes's account of freedom, morality, and domination. Hobbes, as I suggested, presented a very straightforward and very deterministic account of human action. The passions determine action. Will is just a name for the strongest passion that actually determines action in any given instance. Reason, he says, is but the scout for the passions and has no independent role in determining action. Locke also wants to do away, though, with mystical entities like free will, but he sees that Hobbes's account is phenomenologically untrue. We have a constant sense of something like will as intervening in our actions. We have a sense of ourselves as not merely puppets on the strings of our actions, of our passions, sorry. We readily distinguish, for example, impulsive from considered action. None of this comports that well with Hobbes's account of human action. Locke retains, however, the Hobbesian idea that the passions are the driving force of action, but he notes that we have an unconquerable sense of ourselves as free. To give a more adequate account of this phenomenon, Locke introduces the idea of happiness as that ultimate good that human beings seek in their actions. On the basis of this human commitment to happiness, he also introduces the idea of suspension, which is, in his treatment, the basis for affirming both freedom and moral responsibility. And I'm going to try to explain what he's getting at with that. According to Locke, desire moves to action, and happiness moves desire. This is a chain: action, desire, happiness. Happiness, he says, in its full extent, is the utmost pleasure we are capable of, and misery, the utmost pain. Happiness and misery are, Locke points out, or develops, as limit concepts, for they are two extremes, the utmost bounds whereof we know not. That's Locke's language. No human being, he says, has experienced happiness per se. It cannot, therefore, be an idea derived directly from experience. What has been experienced, however, are discrete instances of pleasure and pain, but the mind can generate the idea of happiness and misery from the ideas or experiences of pleasure and pain, extended indefinitely and without admixture of the other. Happiness is thus an imagined state constructed by the mind, yet happiness in general, that is a state of pure positive affect, is what all human beings seek. Seeking happiness, human beings attain a certain degree of distance from the immediate stimuli presented to them. We do not merely respond to this or that stimulus because we seek something more. We seek happiness. Yet happiness per se is a mere abstraction. The pursuit of happiness in turn produces a significant shift from the Hobbesian analysis. Locke affirms a power of suspension and the power to affect and modify our desires themselves. The will remains determined by desire, but the mind or the self can intervene to affect the desire in two ways. First, to suspend the operation of the desires, at least temporarily, and second, to change the, as he puts it, the pleasantness and unpleasantness that accompanies any sort of action, or as he elsewhere puts it, to increase or decrease the relish of our minds to the true intrinsic good or ill that is in things. We can, he says, form appetites in our minds suitable to the object of a given or potential desire. We are able to appropriate and transfer our merely given desires. We can make them ours, not alien to us, in that we are able to work toward integrating these desires into a more or less coherent and whole ordered life that is our own. These miracles are due to the idea of happiness in general. This thing that no eye has ever seen or is or becomes necessarily the ultimate object of our desires. That desire for happiness can supervene between us and the particular desires for this or that that arise within us. Since our real desire is for that general thing, happiness, we are able to suspend this or that particular desire to examine and consider whether pursuit of a given object of desire or a given desire is consistent with happiness. As Locke says, the stronger ties we have to our unalterable pursuit of happiness in general, which is our greatest good, and which, as such, our desires always follow, the more we are free from any necessary determination of our wills to any particular actions and from a necessary compliance with our desire. This power of suspension is not inconsistent with the overall account of willing as determined by desire and as having something of a necessitarian character. The desire for happiness, which is indeed a desire, stands over and above all particular desires by virtue of its generality, and one might even say its emptiness. Its emptiness means that it has no immediate object or action before it, but can prompt the agent to examine all particular desires and objects for likelihood of conducing to happiness per se. The desire for happiness also can lead to the activation or strengthening of desires that do not spontaneously arise or do not arise with great strength by leading the agent to consider carefully what does in fact or is likely to conduce to happiness. If the judgment is made that a certain action or object will do so, then necessarily that object becomes the object of desire as part of our means to happiness. Reason, according to Locke, has a definite role in leading and not just following the passions. All of this discussion of human will and human freedom occurs in Locke's chapter on power. The chapter's title and contents points to the great distance between Hobbes and Locke. For Locke, power above all is the power of self-government, not power over or the recognition of power by others. The primary experience of control, the experience most related to what one most seeks, happiness, is the experience of self-control, of discipline of, rather than simple indulgence of, desire. Thus, Locke in his educational writings can recommend a hard course of training in control of desire for the young in the hope of producing habituation in self-control and therefore ease in resisting immediate desire and in cultivating those desires most likely to lead to happiness. Locke speaks in the educational treatise of the human love to be treated as rational creatures, and he goes on to call this a pride that should be nourished in children. Human pride, justifiable pride, is just the kind of liberty or power of the mind that Locke has discussed in his chapter on power. In language Locke hardly used, we have here the core of human dignity as he understands it, self-mastery, not mastery over others. And it is this core that allows Locke to ditch Hobbes' Leviathan state and to launch liberalism by outlining a regime of liberty. What makes Locke's achievement so important is that he carves out room for freedom, for human agency, when the other moderns challenged agency, and room for moral responsibility when this too was obfuscated by early modern philosophy. Locke laid the ground for seeing humans as free and capable of living freely, while at the same time affirming the laws of cause and effect of the new science. Thank you.
I'd like to first thank Carter Sneed for the invitation and thank everyone at the Center for Ethics and Culture for their very warm hospitality and all of the care they've for the care that they've taken to put on this very well produced conference. It's been a real joy to be here. The name of my paper is Locke's Revision of the Will, Binding Freedom to Power. There is little controversy concerning the importance of John Locke for the political vision of the American Founding Fathers and indeed for the conception of politics in the modern West more generally. But what Locke means is deeply controversial, both in the sense that he is notoriously elusive in his manner of discourse, often undermining a few pages later the foundation of a principle on which he had just constructed a key portion of his theoretical edifice, and in the sense that it is not clear whether the theoretical edifice that finally manages to stand is in fact a fit dwelling for the human person. Some, for example, take Locke's notion of rights to be an indispensable basis for any sound political order in the modern world, and argue that whatever strains of radicalized individualism that critics have claimed to detect in his theory are buffered by his recognition of a natural justice of mutual respect. While others have sought to show that his theory of rights represents a departure from the classical tradition that prioritizes the common good and tends to erode relentlessly any such buffer, What I wish to suggest in this very brief presentation is that a fruitful engagement in these controversies ought to start more basically. Assessing Locke, I think, requires a deeper investigation into the anthropological foundation of his political thought. If political order in general is ultimately an organization of human freedom, then coming to grips with a person's understanding of the nature of human freedom is crucial if we are to interpret his political philosophy adequately. So if this is true, then in order to think fruitfully about Locke's politics, we must undertake a study of his articulation of the nature of the human will and its freedom in the essay concerning human understanding, which we've already begun to do with Professor Zuckert's paper. For those who are not Locke experts, just very briefly, this essay was published 1689, 1690, along with his better known, maybe, letter of concerning toleration and second treatise, although those two, second treatise of government, those two were anonymous. The point of the book is to offer as pure as possible an empiricist epistemology, to try to consider the mind as a clean slate. And this is part of the argument that I'm going to be making, sort of detached from any prior tradition and context, to begin in a way entirely ex nihilo in a certain sense, and then to uncover all of the most basic concepts that populate the mind, draw them out of our experience of the world. And as Professor Zuckert said, the chapter I'm focusing on is 21 of Book 2, which is of power. So Locke takes the will. The reason he even talks about the will and freedom is he's trying to figure out where we get this idea of active power. So his notion of the will is a paradigm of power. Okay. What I propose to do in this presentation is offer a sketch of an interpretation of Locke's view of the will by contrasting it with a more traditional view. So we saw a contrast with Hobbes. I'm going to look at a classical view and then indicate a general political implication. More specifically, I want to suggest that we can read Locke's substantial revisions of the essay. So when he first published it, there were a lot of criticisms, especially of that chapter on the will, and he very substantially rewrote it. It became almost twice as long and continued back over and over to revisit the problem. So I'm going to look at the revisions that he makes between the first and the second essay edition. And look at those as Locke's making an effort to disentangle his new view of freedom from residual strands of the traditional conception. So to such an extent that we can read this revision symbolically in a way as the birth of the modern conception of freedom. So in his disentangling it, we're seeing the very birth of the modern conception of freedom in a symbolical sense. I mean, obviously, there are clear antecedents in Martin Luther, in William Ockham, Scotus, and so forth. Some people go all the way back to Augustine as the origin of the modern sense of the will. But in any event, this, I think, represents a kind of symbol of the birth of the modern conception of freedom. In order to bring out the specificity of Locke's way of conceiving the will, which I will suggest is a binding of freedom to power, I will set it into relief by means of a contrast with the classical notion of will represented by Thomas Aquinas, and to do so on two basic points, namely, what most fundamentally determines the will and what represents the will's proper object. So in other words, we will be comparing these two figures on their respective understandings of where the will begins and where it ends. And then I will conclude with a gesture toward the political implications of the differences here. So, to get right to the point, in his discussion of the nature of the will in the first edition of the essay, Locke poses the question, what is it that determines the will and the choices it makes? And he responds with an answer that resonates in some sense with one of the traditional views of the matter, although it's not in fact the same, but that's another story. Locke writes quite clearly that, quote, the will is determined by something without itself. Good, then, the greater good, is that which determines the will. In his first edition here, Locke denied that human beings have free will in the strictest sense and insisted instead that the adjective free, or unfree applies only to the actions of an agent and not to what is but a power exercised by an agent. So we can say that a man is free when he has the power to carry out his will in action, but it is nonsensical to speak of the will as free, since the will does not itself carry out an action. Friends of Locke, however, and also some rather unfriendly critics, reacted vigorously to Locke's formulations, which seemed to make the will a sort of a passive respondent to external stimuli, and thus to compromise one of the chief aspects of human dignity, namely man's ability to rise above the determinations of mere nature, which was an issue in Hobbes we just saw. These criticisms caused Locke to rethink the matter, not simply to satisfy his critics, but more basically because if the criticisms were true, it would represent the utter failure of this important chapter in the essay. The reason that Locke undertook to discuss the tricky matter of freedom in the will in the first place in this book is because he had identified the will as the sole source of one of the most fundamental ideas populating the human mind, namely the idea of power. In his search for the empirical origin of the idea of what he specified as active power, the ability to effect a change, Locke had decided that the human will was finally the only source available. Everything we experience in nature, he explained, is a mere transfer of power, never an initiating cause. Natural events are always links in a causal chain. What is needed for the idea of active power is a cause, he said, that is not a link in some natural chain, but the origin of its own chain, a first beginning of change. And this, he proposed, we find in the will alone. Given the role that the will plays in the essay, it is clearly inadequate to interpret it as determined without itself, which is how he put it in the first edition. Since this would turn the act of will into a mere transfer of power rather than an originating source. So in the second and subsequent editions, he therefore writes instead, quote, what is it determines the will? The true and proper answer is the mind. And then to clarify, when he faces in turn the obvious follow-up question, namely what determines the mind, Locke says that while it is always potentially moved by the unease generated by natural causes and the desires they provoke, the mind always retains over these a power to suspend, which we just heard about. This power is able, in a certain sense, to veto the proposed desires. It's able to cancel out the motive force of any given stimulus, which is what allows us fairly to say, in the end, for Locke, that the human agent always has the final say in the determination of the will, and so is ultimately accountable to itself alone for its decisions. The act of will, thus, can ultimately be traced back to the self by itself. Okay, so that's the first change. The second change, to which I would like to draw your attention, concerns the end of the volitional act. In correspondence with one of the acquaintances who had written him with criticisms, Locke explained the revisions he introduced in the second edition and made the following rather cryptic remark. This is from a letter to Molyneux. Quote, I myself, being not very well satisfied by the conclusion I was led to that my reasonings were perfectly right, reviewed that chapter again with great care, and by observing only the mistake of one word, namely having put things for actions, which was very easy to be done in the place where it is, I got into a new view of things. So this reason, the reason that this remark is cryptic is that Locke quite evidently changed a lot more than a single word. He doubled the size of the chapter. And in fact, Locke didn't go on to elaborate in the letter what significance such a change, what this new view of things is, that he indicated. He didn't say what that was. Scholars in general are wont to dismiss or at least minimize the remark because of this strangeness, but it seems to me profoundly significant once we consider it in relation to a classical account of a will, as we'll see in just a moment. The passage in the new edition that Locke seems especially to have in mind is the following. Whereas in the first edition he had written that, quote, the act of willing signifies nothing properly but the actual producing of some thing that is voluntary. In the second edition, he writes instead, the will or power of volition is conversant about nothing but our own actions, terminates there, and reaches no further. Now, I want to highlight especially the last part of this sentence, terminates there, and reaches no further. In order to remain consistent with his interpretation of the will as active power, and so is a spontaneous and effective force that is not beholden, so to speak, to anything lying outside of itself, Locke has to restrict its effective scope. Distinguishing the will from our desires, which are generally set on something outside of ourselves, desires are the world, in a certain sense, calling us to itself. They're responsive to something outside of ourselves. Locke distinguishes the will from our desires because these are, in some decisive respect, beyond our control, and thereby he limits the reach. And in order to do so, he limits the reach of the will to the agent himself. So properly speaking, for Locke, I cannot be said to will something, some reality that faces me and is different from myself. But finally, what I will is only my own actions in that thing's regard, because only my actions lie, properly speaking, under my control. Interpreted principally as power, the will originates in the self and terminates in the self. And the self never transcends itself in its acts of will. It never manages to get outside of its own agency to connect with the world. The conception of freedom as power locks the ego up essentially inside of itself. The weight of this point begins to reveal itself when we contrast this conception with the traditional view represented by Aquinas. According to the medieval thinker, what specifically distinguishes the will from the intellect in the relation that these powers of the soul bear to the reality that lies extra animum, outside of the soul, is that while the act of intellect, he says, terminates in the soul itself, which means that when we understand reality, we take it into ourselves, the act of will terminates not in the agent or its actions, but in things, in rebus, in the reality of the world outside the soul. In other words, the will for Aquinas, far from locking the soul in itself, is precisely the power by which the soul transcends itself into reality. And thus we can say it's precisely the will that allows the agent to make genuine contact with the world. Now, one of the metaphysical axioms generally recognized in classical philosophy is the coincidence of origin and end in movements of the spirit. Spiritual acts by nature return finally to their point of origin, which is what completes them. We have just seen a confirmation of this truth in Locke's conception of the will, which we saw he was driven by the logic of the will as active power, exercise of active power, it forced him in a way to say that the will doesn't go anywhere but into the agent himself, that it's purely self-contained, self-referential. In Aquinas, by contrast, the act of will does indeed terminate beyond the agent in things themselves, but this can be the case, in fact, only because the will also originates from outside of the agent. In the Prima Secundae of the Summa, question 9, Aquinas explains that, quote, the principle of this motion, the act of the will, lies in the end, which he goes on to say is the good in general. Aquinas, in fact, defines the will not as active power, but as intellectual appetite. And an appetite is the etymology suggests, not a spontaneous outburst or eruption, but an essentially receptive movement towards, ad petere, a movement towards, and specifically a being drawn to some good. What distinguishes the intellectual appetite of the will from a sensible appetite, such as hunger, is that while hunger is set on a sensible and therefore always particular good, the will is set on the good specifically in its truth, which means that the will is defined as a desire for the universal good. And it bears emphasis here, this point. It's not that the universal good should be something that I desire and should be something that I promote. But in fact, the desire for the will before any decision I make is precisely what defines each of our individual wills. Because we've become so accustomed to a Lockean psychology, it's not easy to grasp what Aquinas is saying here, but it is important that we do so. My own act of will, every one of my acts of will, takes its origin not in me, but in the universal good outside of me. And this is why it is also able to terminate outside of me, beyond me, in the real good of things in the world. So, does this imply that our will is passive, a resistanceless function of the objective truth of the good, a puppet, so that we fall back into the model of a mere transfer of power that worried Locke so much? Not in the least. In the first place, and this is a crucial point, the very question presupposes improper terms. We need to reject that very question. Locke took for granted that the operation of the will is a matter of effective power, and power is essentially divisive. So given the terms, the more the will is acted on by what's outside of it, by an external power, the more passive it is, the less power it has in itself. So if we want to reinforce the power, we have to minimize the significance of things outside of it. To increase its power requires us to the capacity to neutralize any alien force. And this is what this power to suspend, in fact, amounts to. But Aquinas does not think of the will principally in terms of power, or at least not as Locke understands power. Instead, he thinks of the will principally in terms of goodness. And goodness implies a positive relation to otherness and difference. It's essentially participatory. Thus, when Aquinas asks the question that Locke raises, what determines the will and its acts, he is not left to negotiate an either-or. Instead, he lists several possibilities in the six articles of question 9. Is it the intellect that determines the will? Is it the sensible appetite that determines the will? Is it the will itself that determines itself? Is it some extrinsic principle? Is it a heavenly body? Is it God? Which of these determines the will? And Aquinas' answer is yes. Except for the heavenly body part, he rejects astrology. But all the others determine the will. All of these, in a distinct way, contribute to the single act of will. They all are co-acting in each of my acts of will. The universal good, as perceived by the intellect, is the principle, the beginning of the motion. The will, disposed in one way or another by the sensible appetite, directs the energy of this attraction, you might say, this attraction to the good, to some proximate particular object as a means to that end, and the whole of this motion is itself caused by God, who is absolute goodness and the cause of all created goods, including the good of the will in its own acts. None of these causes excludes the others, but quite to the contrary, they all prove to enhance each other when they are in the proper order. The more God is present to the will as goodness, for example, the more the will is capable of moving itself in its choices, the more free it is. So what is the point of laying all of this out, however tersely here? The point is to show that the will in Aquinas always acts inside of a context that precedes it and gives it shape, intelligibility, and direction. It always acts as part of a larger whole, and indeed as basically subordinate to the order of that whole. This order is internal to the will in its operation, which is why the presence of this order does not compromise the integrity of the will, its autonomy or freedom. The various others to the self, the body, the givenness of nature, other creatures, other human beings, the family into which one is born, the human community within which one comes to mature selfhood, the church into which one has been perhaps baptized prior to any choice, and indeed God himself, who is so absolutely other, he is, as Nicholas of Cusa said, the non-other, which is a paradox, none of these in principle stand over against the self as competing agents, the relationship to which would then have to be negotiated and merely externally regulated. Instead, all these can be understood in principle as conditions of freedom, supports for the genuine exercise of the will, enhancements of genuinely human autonomy. To conclude, it is against the backdrop of what we might call an essentially rooted sense of the will in the classical anthropology that we can see the epic-making implications of Locke's revision of the will and his binding of freedom to power. It seems to me that the notion of will and the related concept of the self presents a somewhat hidden foundation of the various controversies I mentioned at the outset, and so needs to be addressed. to take just one of the most obvious examples, the importance of the question of the relative priority of right or the good, or the related question of the relative priority of rights or duties, is secondary, it seems to me, to this question of the nature of the will. It does not, for example, help to overcome what critics argue is the essentially self-centered character of rights that we see in Locke by insisting on the priority of the good, if the good remains the object of the will understood as active power. Because the relation to the good and to all others in the good will inevitably reduce in this case to functions of an essentially self-referential form of freedom. By contrast, if we recover a notion of the will as rooted in the manner just described, then even a kind of prioritizing of rights poses no problem. Because rights will always turn out to be entailments of subjects whose freedom is formed in a principial way by the objective order in which that freedom arises. Thus, for example, the right to marriage would be prioritized in this context not as arbitrary choice, but as a right to, and therefore necessarily, always coincidentally, a duty towards the natural God-given reality that is marriage, and so on. It seems to me that in order to come to terms with Locke and what he represents in the context of contemporary Western culture, we need to see through his notoriously elusive and even misleading prose to the basic ideas at their foundation, which he attempted to present, rather unusually in his own name, in the essay concerning human understanding. It is only thus that we can finally liberate freedom from its modern bondage to power. Thank you.
All right, well, it's rare to have two papers speak to each other, I think, so closely. I don't know if this was premeditated or if it, an act of will or if it just happened. But so what I'd ask is, we have about 5 more minutes with the presence of Professor Zuckert. So if you have questions that are specifically to his paper, I'd ask that please try to ask yours soon. All right, thank you. But questions for anybody are fine, and we have plenty of time to go.
I have a question for Professor Zuckert. My question is, how do we know that Locke isn't actually a determinist all the way down when he talks about the suspension of the will? For example, in paragraph 51 of the section of powers, he says, "We are by the necessity of preferring and pursuing true happiness as our greatest good, obliged to suspend the satisfaction of our desire in particular cases." And then in section 52, "Whatever necessity determines to the pursuit of real bliss, the same necessity with the same force establishes suspense, deliberation, and scrutiny of each successive desire, whether the satisfaction of it does not interfere with our true happiness and mislead us from it." So how do we know, what do we make of those kinds of passages? And how do we know that there's a genuine place of freedom, the suspension of it?
Well, that's a good question. And I would say, in a way, yeah, Locke is, at the end of the day, there's a necessitarian dimension to Locke. And I think the passages you point out point to some of the disagreements between my reading of Locke and Professor Schindler's, because in his account he didn't mention happiness at all, which in my understanding of it is crucial to understanding what Locke is trying to say about will and its relation to human action. Human action isn't simply self-forming, I think, as he said, but it's related to happiness, which is in turn related to the natural universe in which we find ourselves. So at the end of the day, Locke would say, yes, there is something necessitarian here, but on the other hand, there is an actual intrusion of the human agent in those in the action, according to which we can speak of, in a plausible way, freedom, not just something that's pure spontaneity, but something that would also be speaking of freedom, and which also will suffice for impugning moral responsibility to agents. So that is one of the things Locke is very concerned with in this discussion, is to find a ground on which it makes sense to hold people responsible for what they've done, so as to make, for example, punishment morally acceptable. And also to make room, give some explanation for the fact that we live our lives with a sense that moral responsibility is a key part of it. Somebody like Hobbes doesn't leave us a way to understand why that should be so, and Locke tries to do so. But I think at the end of the day, there is something necessary.
it seems to me when you interpret the will in terms
which is distinct from a classical notion of potency ordered to act, then it sets into motion a dialectic. And so it's interesting in Locke, what you see is simultaneously a pure power and a pure impotence, because everything there's a kind of a dialectical opposition that defines every level. So you have interpretations of Locke that read him as a pure libertarian, pure spontaneous free choice, and then you have others that read him as just a fancy version of Hobbesian determinism. And I think both of those readings are absolutely correct, actually.
I think they're both wrong.
The issue of happiness, I mean, it's defined. I mean, this is one of the issues. It is the case that understanding happiness forms freedom in a certain respect, but you are free to choose what makes you happy. I mean, so in a way, it becomes, I think, ultimately a certain self-referential undermining of what would otherwise have been a classical principle.
More questions?
Professor Zuckert, adjacent to...
Stand up so we can hear. Thank you. Try to remember the room is hard to have everyone there.
Well, adjacent to the point you just raised, could you elaborate more on something you mentioned in your presentation, which is the emptiness of our concept of happiness?
Well, yes, okay. That's my presentation was necessarily a bit shorthand. I think all of us were under the pressure of 20 minutes, and we're both trying to talk about pretty complicated things. And my presentation was actually an excerpt from a much longer paper that I have. And probably there are many gaps in what I had said today that the excerpt character is responsible for. But the what I had in mind by the emptiness is that there isn't, for Locke, the idea of happiness is an idea that we form from our experiences, our individual experiences of pleasant, unpleasant, pleasure and pain in effect. But I want to insist that we not understand pleasure and pain simply in terms of bodily pleasures and pains. That's not Locke's view of it. States of affect in which we would like to remain, let's put it that way, something like that. And that the idea of happiness is formed by a mental process which indeed leaves us with an idea of a state of pure positive affect. That is itself the way it's formed without context other than pure positive affect. But as we live our lives, we come to fill it in, so to speak. We come to realize that there are some kinds of things that if we do, we're not going to achieve what we're seeking, that is, this kind of happiness. And so therefore, Locke's theory of action, if you want to call it that, is in constant dialogue with our experience of the world, the consequences of our actions. And for Locke, good education is an education which helps the young to form good ideas of what content happiness actually should have. But in its immediate formation, there is something empty about it, and it gets filled in. And often it gets filled in differently from different people because we have different experiences of the world. And this is why I think Locke, you know, gives us room for understanding different cultures and so on, which come to understand happiness differently. Does that help?
Yes, thank you.
Can I follow this question? So, Michael, in your view... Michael, in your view, is there a continuity in classical conceptions of happiness from Aristotelian understanding with Locke's understanding, or is there some kind of fundamental break or departure? And if so, is it the character that Professor Schindler has described? And I also just pose a quick question to Professor Schindler. What, in your view, is Locke's understanding then of the will, Locke's understanding, will to reality, and what is the human interaction? Because there is a reality out there outside of ourselves. What becomes our relationship to reality by your reading of Locke?
I'll take the first cut at it. In a way, I see Locke's development as a move back towards classical theory. I think, to some degree, what Locke has noticed is that Aristotle was really right as compared to Hobbes? Because Hobbes seems to think that we're driven by desire, this and that immediate desire for this and that immediate pleasure. Hobbes only speaks of happiness or felicity when he says there's no such thing. Whereas what Locke comes to see is that, phenomenologically speaking, that's looking at how human beings really are, how we experience ourselves, we seek something more than this or that particular thing. We do seek something more comprehensive. And the name he gives it, following Aristotle, is happiness. So I think in that regard, there's a lot of continuity between Locke and Aristotle. There are obviously differences between Locke and Aristotle also, and that difference, I think, has to do, at the end of the day, with Aristotle's more structured account of the one and only path to happiness. Locke is more open on that than Aristotle is. He's less confident that he has his hand on the sort of very structured universe, all pointing out towards one good, et cetera, than Aristotle. So I'd say there's an important continuity, but there's also a break.
Yeah, there's different paths or different conceptions of good, individual conceptions. Is it different paths for Locke? Because you also seem to suggest
Locke is trying to give an account of what people actually do. And he notices that different people do have different conceptions of the good, of happiness. And he doesn't make the move that I think Professor Schindler wants to make, or Aquinas makes, or maybe the Christian tradition as well makes, and just say, well, yes, all of those are really, God is the aim of all of those. He doesn't make that move. So that would be it. If you take what Locke actually says, he identifies happiness, real happiness, with the afterlife, with achieving salvation. Yeah. But not all people are naturally doing. There are some people who never heard of salvation. So,
to answer the second part of the question, just to make a comment there, I mean, he says about the highest good, to ask after the highest good, we may as well ask what's better for dessert, fruits, or nuts. Everybody has their own tastes. It seems to me that there's a difference when you think of God. You open up God, you don't close off the possibility. I think that's absolutely crucial. But it's very different when you think of God as a possibility. Then God becomes the object of my choice, which is a fundamentally different God than the one who's created the world. But in terms of, so what is the contact with reality? I mean, in a way, it's very simple. You know, for Locke, you act on reality. So the will terminates in things in the sense of hitting them. It's effective power. Things in my activity, I end up just acting on reality, and that becomes very evident in the second treatise when he talks about property, the labor value, labor theory of value. Reality has essentially no intrinsic value except what we put in through our acting on it. And so I think it's very much, it's a pretty radical break from the classical tradition.
Let's give them.
I think that becomes absolutely insoluble when you think of it. So
And now that we're only one person, this could be really helpful for the people in the extremes here. Thank you very much.
So when you think of in terms of power, I mean, it does become an either or, and so the causality is essentially in competition, and that's why I mean. The question was put to Locke by a friend of his, you know, how can you harmonize your notion of freedom with God's omnipotence? And he says, I have no idea, it's beyond me, so I'm not going to think about it. Literally, he just says, you know, he literally sort of punts on the question. It's very different if you think in terms of goodness. If God causes in terms of being the absolute good that draws us, it's a causality that's not acting on us. It's a causality that's actually liberating and inviting towards. And so, I mean, there's absolutely no competition there. I mean, quite to the contrary. The more you are warmly invited, the more free you are to respond. So I think it's the simple point. Goodness, priority of goodness as opposed to the priority of power. Kind of breaks the back of the conundrum there.
Yes.
I really wanted to ask this to Dr. Zuckert, but I think you can also speak to this. Do you think that there's any account in Locke of a possibility of someone having a happiness which they believe to be happiness, but is not in fact, like as in the classical tradition in the work in Plato, etc.?
I think that's really an excellent question, and it's one. I mean, I've wondered that myself. I mean, that's a fascinating question just in itself to wonder about. Can you not only can you be wrong about what makes you happy, but can you be wrong about what you find pleasurable? It's kind of an interesting twist on that. But with Locke, I mean, he actually says if there were no afterlife, he defers the issue in a way. If there's no afterlife, then he says there's absolutely no distinction between the real good and the apparent good. He says that explicitly. What in the world does the afterlife add to that? Punishment or reward? The question of eschatological happiness is a question of the extrinsic heaven and hell. That, I mean, and he's explicit about that in the essay.
Thank you for the lecture. I'd like to know
as loudly as possible. Try to remember it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Besides this freedom to power, mm-hmm. we have also in modernity or postmodernity the power of the will, departing from Nietzsche, mm-hmm. and this pleasure of being our rulers without any criteria, no, and this happiness to have no moral criteria. Do you think it is a consequence or like from Locke to?
See, it would be very interesting to hear Professor Zuckert respond to that because he would want, it's presumptuous to say, but I suspect, and I think he would be right in doing this, that there's a profound difference between the Nietzschean thing that you described and Locke. Locke wants to insist that our freedom not be arbitrary, that we respect other people, that we follow the moral law. I mean, so in a way, he builds in all sorts of, and this is one of the reasons why there's so many controversies in reading Locke. But my sense is that underneath that is once you define. I mean, that's why I think that the discussion of Locke has to begin at this point, because once you define the will as active power, I think there's nothing you can do. So for all of, I think Locke himself would absolutely reject that Nietzschean view, but I think that it's built into the logic of his conception is what I would propose.
Thank you so much.
Any more questions?
Well, I
yes.
Would follow up on that because Nietzsche speaks of volition. Strangely, he says, people don't understand volition. They think it's some simple thing, right? And as an example of volition, he says, for example, the will to strike a blow. And so it's conflictual. We think the will is autonomous, but it's actually conflictual. Or it's conflictual in certain situations. I spent a lifetime working with René Girard's work, which is mimetic nature of the will, desire, which can become intensely conflictual, rivalistic. So it's then the question is, how does Christianity respond to that? And Christianity presents another object for mimetic desire, or the mimetic awakening of one's will. If someone reaches for an object indicating his desirability, I want to reach for it myself. What Christianity does is it points to Christ, who's pointing to the Father, that takes that will and returns it to its original ordering, which I think is really the only way out of this.
Thank you.
How does the Lockean state deal with disordered desires, especially concerning limits on freedom?
Especially with the last point. Especially
limit freedom.
Limit freedom.
I mean, that's one of the things that really is interesting about Locke in comparison to Hobbes, because in a way he says that there's limiting. As I suggested, it just seems to me this is one of the reasons why there's so much controversy with him, because he never posits lawless freedom. I mean, freedom is always limited, And this is why there's so many people who want to harmonize him with a classical view that wants to reconcile freedom and order. But the key to me is not whether whether freedom is lawless or lawful. That's not the most basic question. It's a question. A more basic question there is whether law is something that internally forms freedom by opening it up to the good, or law is understood as an extrinsic limit that's placed on what would otherwise be empty, and that's a more basic question. That second position is demonstrably Locke's, and once he takes that position, it's quite in a way he can recover so much apparently of the classical tradition. So he's all about self-control, as Professor Zuckert said, controlling our passions with a view to heaven, eternal reward. So that's not the problem for Locke. Self-control is not the problem. It's control. It's conceiving the will as a matter of control that I think is a more basic issue.
We're coming in for one more question. Yes.
I just wanted to see if you could clarify a point you made at the very end of your talk. The issue of the priority of the right over the good is like one which has been a lot of ink spilled. And it seemed like, so you indicated that if the will isn't self-referential as it is in Locke, then that question basically evaporates. And I was hoping, like, that seems like a promising way to deal with that question. Am I understanding you right? So if the will is a receptive movement towards some good, then automatically, of course, the right is prior, the good is prior to the right, is if that's what the will is.
Right.
You could expand on that.
Right. I mean, and at the root, that would be the case. And I don't want to say that the problem would just simply disappear, but I think that in a way, you see that it's a relative concern, because the problem is insoluble unless you solve this more basic problem about the very nature of the will and the nature of freedom. It seems to me that, right, if you understand rights is founded in a natural freedom that is already formed, always already in relation to good, the good and the concrete establishment of that good in community, then this is an example that comes to mind. I don't know if this would be helpful, but I mean, it's sort of, if you have a love relationship between two people, you know, who loves the other first? In a certain sense, the priority, it doesn't matter. I mean, it becomes a less significant question, because the unity
informs both of them. So I guess that would be the point. When we understand the right, the will as ordered by the good and not just to the good. So freedom for, the distinction of freedom from and freedom for, I think, is not itself helpful. It's not just freedom for the good, but it's freedom that's always been ordered by the good, even prior to its exercise. There's no tension. Which one you start with becomes just a matter of context. They point to the same direction, I think.
Well, please join me in thanking.